many people are here or at the university that I feel like I should just say a moment of thanks to. When I left the University of Rochester, I was the Roswell Burroughs professor. And I was the first woman to hold a chair. And everybody thought I was totally crazy to come here. Well, I've been totally happy here. And it has to do with the wonderful students and colleagues and friends that I have. A whole bunch of my graduate students are here. If you're my current or former graduate student, could you stand up and impress the audience for a minute? I have a whole line of graduate assistants, some of whom did research on what I'm going to read today. And the deans, the head of international programs, a series of provosts and department heads have all contributed money for me to take graduate students to London and show them just how much you can have fun getting dirty in an archive. People won't sit by you in a tube if you work in archives. That's how dirty you get. And of course, there's the library and Dean Bonnie McEwen and Jenna Alibi, the area librarian. But most of all, it's my colleagues who are stimulating and generous and let me try out ideas on them. And some of them are not in the English department. So I just wanted to thank you. And so I thought today I would show you what I do. In a way, there are pieces from a book in progress from two different chapters. But it's also, I think for many people, this will be sort of the way I think, and also the way cultural studies works. So let's see another picture. I do. Maybe we could have dimmer lights. I don't know about lighting. Can you all see that? So my topic today is staging wartime women. And two of the iconic images of the Vietnam War are of young women. One fleeing a napalm attack and one kneeling over the body of a college student shot at an anti-war demonstration. We are teaching a generation of students whose country has been at war their whole lives. Okay, you don't want to black out this speech. I should have one of those lights that old people have for restaurants. Okay, that'll be good. If you can't see the images, I'll just describe them or act them out. Anyway, we are teaching a generation of students whose country has been at war their whole lives. And sometimes it seems to me that my research becomes more timely month by month, as we have learned about kidnapped schoolgirls in Africa, and no longer think it noteworthy to see photographs of women soldiers in almost every country in the world, wearing camouflage and carrying assault rifles. Women are not just fighters and captives, of course. They have to supply the frontline soldiers. This is a World War II piece of propaganda. The idea is that women should supply the frontline soldiers willingly. They are the objects of intense propaganda. Notice that there's a little boy who will be sent someday, but there are the women looking out of the window saying, go. These were major posters, and this year they are collector's item in the UK. Women were the objects of intense propaganda in the 18th century too. One of my favorite campaigns was the Happy Mother campaign. In that, you would see a beautiful kitchen table, and around it there would be these happy, chubby-cheeked children and a happy, chubby-cheeked, flourishing mother. And over in the corner, there would be a scrawny old maid. She was always wearing gray, had a tatty little scarf. And so this showed you that if you really wanted to be happy, you had to be the mother of all these children, and they needed soldiers. Now, in 2005, during the Iraq War in the U.S., the military launched a campaign to persuade parents, especially mothers, to stop resisting their sons' enlistment. As with the Happy Mother campaign of the 18th century, kitchen tables were prominent. The Army had missed its recruiting target by 80,000. Every knew that almost every soldier who enlisted was headed for combat. And a Stanford-educated general loaded with video games, helicopter simulations, and cash was appointed head of Army recruiting. As the Chicago Tribune wrote, "The Army is looking for a few good parents." The ads, which appeared widely in the Food Network and Home and Garden magazine, often included dialogues between, usually, a son who wanted to enlist and his mother, who is depicted as standing in the way of the child's enlistment and his or her future. One features a teenager telling his mother that he has found a way to pay for college, enlist. During the 2013 fight against rebels near Fallujah, a government soldier said that, quote, his mother was so terrified of the fighting that she burned his uniform every time he returned home on leave, end quote. Then she threatened to kill herself if he went back, and he deserted. Especially during the mid-18th century wars, when the Royal Navy grew from 17,000 to nearly 75,000, wartime women were supposed to sacrifice their men, even if it meant economic hardship. In Henry Carey's Nancy, Nancy goes from confronting and protesting a press gang to send her fiancé off to fight the War of Jenkins Ear with the song, "For sweet revenge and slaughter are all my heart's desire." You may remember the press gangs are the ones who kidnapped men or got them drunk and shoved them on ships and turned them into fighters. The book I've been working on for a few years is about the uses of representations of women during wartime. My position is that wartime women in all times and places are texts on which patriotism, struggle, mourning, and violation are written. Think of the two Vietnam images as well as this one. I always seem to obsess about two kinds of dissection. One is the dynamic among an event, a text, and the audience. And the other is the struggle between the formulaic ways of meaning making and the interpreting audience, or between the hegemony and the uninitiated or uneducated or resisting consumer. In this book, I'm especially interested in the way women or femininity were used by men to further their causes. It seems appropriate, even necessary, to begin in 1658, the time when, for the first time, women performed in plays in the Royal London Theatres. For the first time, women could be written on, made into public texts, part of the wartime literature and even milieu. What these bodies reveal, if one inches forward through theatrical seasons, revises our conceptions of women's roles, and also what work plays do in a culture. This approach provides another way to flesh out and study the situation of women at specific moments in time. And sometimes that situation is conveyed more starkly than in other kinds of plots. The women's bodies are both historical constructions, revealing the changing situation of women, and theatrical constructions bearing the traces of traditional, even conventional roles within formulated plots and within their gendered society. They are, therefore, texts of culture. We know that the plays that last longest and are most familiar to us are both exceptionally entertaining and exceptionally subject to re-accentuation. Some of those plays come immediately to mind. John Gay's Beggar's Opera is certainly one. Unfortunately for you, however, the most profound plays for me are those that record a moment quite specifically. They participate very actively in change, but once the change comes about, they are obsolete. If they do enter the repertory, it is because new audiences have found attractions and meanings in them very different from their original purposes. This is true of two of the plays I'm going to talk about, Nathaniel Lee's Rival Queens and Robert Howard's The Committee. In many cases, however, these authors of plays are part of radical, successful changes and have both specific, pointed purposes in immediate situations. In contrast, Venice Preserved becomes pertinent in any time that citizens are forced to contemplate resistance or rebellion. In Venice Preserved, which is a play that most 18th century people aren't familiar with, the hero is caught between choosing to join the rebels in a time when people are starving and the government is really abusive and ineffectual and exploitive, and remaining loyal to the government where his wife's father is a senator. And he wavers back and forth, and the choice becomes increasingly painful. So it's a really interesting play to study. It makes that momentary point well, because in America, the rebels were the heroic group, and it was a very popular play during the colonial period. To look closely at the plays produced between 1658 and 1678 might seem an easy undertaking, because there are not many. In fact, anarchy, not even chaos, describes repertories. Many plays were revived, of course. Some with revisions worthy of analysis. Some were written or adapted from continental plays at King Charles' request. Some came from the streets, and livery company performances such as Cutter of Coleman Street. Two quite different wartime women appear in them. One group is composed of women who stayed, mostly in London. While the men have been away with the army or in exile, the women have had to live and therefore make compromises with the victors at home. They had to retain or regain family property. Many of these early characters are widows, but occupy very different spaces in the plots from the lascivious, satirized widows of comedies performed only a decade later. Women in breeches parts are in disguise, often as rather lower-class urchins or errand boys, and are usually mature rather than ingenues. They do not assume dueling positions in order to let their breasts pop out to reveal their sex to please the audience. Robert Howard's The Committee is related to the rowdy plays performed in a variety of places before and during the interregnum. It has a Cromwell figure and a crass, ignorant committee of safety. All of the women are wartime women. Some of them are the winners, who have formed a society of influence to enrich themselves. Mrs. Day is the worst. A self-satisfied, crude, aristocratic former kitchen maid who leads the committee that forces their decisions on the official committee. These women are the past. Her victims, Arabella and Ruth, are the present. The Days have appropriated Ruth's property. Arabella is petitioning for her property, something Robert Howard would know well, as he was a member of the Commission for Concealed Land, the committee charged with recovering the king's and high courtiers' lands. Ruth, one of the leading characters, is an excellent example of a crisis text. She is a bridge between the Days and the impoverished cavaliers all around her, and importantly, exposes the uncompromising rigidity of both the Cromwellian and Cavalier men. She's a wonderful mimic, and at one point, perfectly acts blunt, the Cavalier, who expresses real poignancy and angry grief about his situation. Quote, "Then farewell, Acres, may the dirt choke them." There's a lot of revenge in this place. Ruth coerces, steals documents, threatens people, and blackmails, and brings about the happy ending. This play has troubling dimensions. Ruth does these things, but the Cavalier men will not. At one point, the man courting her says to her, "Poor, kind, perjured, pretty one, I am beholden to thee for swearing to a falsehood." End quote. She and Arabella have a strong sense of property and justice and maneuver successfully in this ugly world. But in the end, they and their property belong to Blunt and Careless, the proper place of a post-war woman. Shortly after this very early play, three plays about Alexander the Great that depict a contrasting class of women were performed in a single year. Now, Ruth and the Days are middle class or lower. These women are royalty. In varying degrees, all of these three plays borrow from Sir Charles Cotterell's translation of Calprenada's romance, Cassandra. In 1676, an elaborate new folio edition of Cassandra came out, and these three theatrical adaptations were produced immediately after this publication, therefore in the tumultuous 1670s. They are Nathaniel Lee's rival queens, the only one likely to be familiar to anyone, John Banks' rival kings, and Samuel Portage's Siege of Babylon. Poor Portage didn't even make it in the OD&B. Immediately before his execution in January 1649, King Charles I gave his copy of Cassandra to the Earl of Lindsay, one of the peers who was staying in the Tower with him. So that's why this book is so special. The king carried it to the Tower, and the night before his head was chopped off, he gave it to his friend. Charles II, while still the exiled Duke of York, asked Cotterell to translate it into English. Most of the romance is about the daughters, Satira and Parasatis, of the defeated and dead King Darius, the king of Persia. An unrelenting experience is a world that had become one of grief rather than power and authority, and a mood of angry sorrow and physical and emotional homelessness. In describing his efforts to deliver the manuscript, Cotterell, who had written it in Antwerp and The Hague, and then transported it to England for publication, cast the characters as like the king in having, quote, exposed themselves by sea to the hazard of storms and bloody fights in passing through the fleets of England and Holland, as they must now by land to that of battles and sieges and going to the armies of Flanders and France. Charles, all three plays actually embody rival viewpoints in male characters, including Charles' decline and style of governing, the question of the divine nature of kings, and Charles' alleged effeminacy in his relationships with women and even in styles of dress. An especially pertinent event was the marriage of Princess Mary to William of Orange on 4 November 1677. That happened right in the middle of the production of these three plays, some before and one after. As in Calprenada's romance, the noble women are either captives or disguised exiles in the time when women were tokens of exchange among kings, pledges approaching hostages, and mere items in a contract. They move through the plays as manifestations of these roles. The maneuvering around the marriage of Charles II was typical of the time. The Portuguese diplomat bribed courtiers, and with the promise of the richest dowry wrought by any queen of England, brought about the marriage of Charles and Catherine of Braganza, daughter of King Juan IV. The Spanish king, Philippe IV, panicked because he didn't want an alliance between England and Portugal, and in turn, he offered the princesses of Parma, then Saxony, and then Denmark to Charles instead. Nothing like a choice of princesses. Perhaps nothing shows the stature of royal women better than the rather sudden marriage of Mary. Charles considered marriage an important diplomatic tool, and in spite of his promise to James that he would not dispose of Mary without his consent, he gave her to William after days of political, not romantic, negotiation. The princess cried almost all of the time from the moment she was told throughout the ceremony. In fact, there's probably an apocryphal story that she wept so much during the ceremony that she reached down and got the train of a bridesmaid's dress and wiped her eyes. I don't find that a real great source. Anyway, Charles, not the father, gave her away as he would Princess Anne in 1683. Banks dedicated his play to Lady Catherine Herbert, daughter of a courtier, whom Leah described in conversation with the princesses regarding the pleasure they had found in Cassandra. And Portage dedicated his to Mario Modena, who would be King James' second queen. So you can see this romance, this text, was woven into the lives of the people in the court and spoke to them at some sort of deep level. Parysatis is the most obvious emblem of Mary, as Alexander and her suitors recognize Alexander's right to give her to whomever he pleases. And he arbitrarily and suddenly will change his mind and assign her to another man. In all three plays, and this is important, when the women attempt to affect or even influence, the result is destructive. They draw loyalists, often ambitious ones, thereby creating divisions within the court. In Lees and Banks' plays, Satira and her sister Parysatis are captives of Alexander. And in Portage's, the Siege of Babylon, Alexander is dead and the women are in claustrophobic, besieged city of Babylon, where Roxana, Alexander's first wife, has Statira in her power. In Lee's play, Roxana, Alexander's first wife, exemplifies the insecurity that such pawn wives experience. In Lee's play, except for Alexander's fantasy of his love for her, Statira is completely powerless. Coerced into being Alexander's second wife, she has a moment of resistance. But after Alexander has slept again with his first wife, she says, quote, "Nor can I ever yield to share your bed. Oh, I shall find Roxana in your arms and taste her kisses left upon your lips," end quote. So she tries a Lysistrata moment where she says, okay, if you keep going back to your second wife, that's it for me. That's the kind of, in the long run, useless attempts at power that the hostage women in these plays and in court had. In the last play I want to talk about in some detail, the time could be accurately described as during a world war. England Preserved was written to depict a wartime woman and performed as propaganda in 1796. In addition to its remarkable rewriting of a woman's part in times of strife, it is interesting because it is an example of the attempt by the highest men in government to use the theater more effectively for propaganda. They contributed £10,000 and commissioned George Watson, an unknown lawyer, to write it. In modern money, that would be more than $1 million. The context for the play are historical, political, and theatrical. The immediate context across the channel for England Preserved was the Reign of Terror, the guillotine, and mobs in the streets. Many politicians believed they needed to hasten the re-education of British sympathizers, people who had seen the French Revolution as a period of constitution making, of benevolent rhetoric, and of peaceful jubilation. In England, the context was a trajectory that included the startling growth of constitutional and corresponding societies and the declaration of war that led to what Hilton called, quote, "an unprecedented amount of repressive legislature," end quote, a true assault on the guarantees, such as habeas corpus, that people had taken for granted. Perhaps the most important theatrical context was the performance of Thomas Otway's Venice Preserved. This had been a kind of a war horse of a play. If you were a theatrical manager, you could put it on. You got soldiers, you got suffering women, you got screens. It was just a great war horse, safe moneymaker. But in this case, in 1794, turmoil and evil legal consequences accompanied the Covent Garden production. Reformers, including John Thelwall, one of the most prominent men charged with treason, propagated speeches from the play. On the first night of the Covent Garden production, Thelwall and his reformist friends had vigorously applauded and demanded encores of parts of the play that highlighted government corruption and the hardships of ordinary people. He published sections of the play as expressions of the reformist cause, and it was said that, quote, "the conspicuous figure Thelwall made in promoting the applause of passages of the play was not forgotten at his trial. And so, in other words, in the trial transcripts, which I've read, they listed where he applauded in the play as evidence of his treason. The Covent Garden production was closed after only two nights. As England Preserve moved toward performance, John Philip Kimball opened a lavish production of Venice Preserve as part of the repertory of classic plays he was mounting for his new Drury Lane Theater. He was stupid enough to say the fact that everybody knew this was a repertory of classic plays was going to protect his production from the Covent Garden fate. It opened in October 1795 and met the same fate. After five performances, it was shut down. He did a couple of things. One thing was that Thirlwall and others had applauded in the speeches that said that people cannot buy bread. And there were bread riots in the streets and countryside of London at that time. So they cut all the speeches about citizens suffering. But the part that really I find most amusing is that he had really good actors and actresses playing the three primary parts. And after people were cheering the leader of the rebels, he replaced him with a drudgy, journeyman, not very good actor. Sort of imagine Willy Loman from Death of a Salesman now leading the rebels. So, but that didn't work either. Did not work. So after five performances, it was shut down. A lesser known political context was the fact that powerful 18th century statesmen would definitely not agree with modern historians who asserted that the government, quote, was adept at using counter-propaganda, end quote. Men around Lord Chancellor Loughborough recognized that the French were doing it better and argued that the government should, quote, make more effective use of the propaganda value of the theater. England Preserve is set shortly after the death of King John, one of the most controversial kings in English history. In the last years of his reign, the barons had objected to his excessive use of force and coercion, raised an army to oppose him, and asked for help from the French. They took London, and their loyalists gave them Rochester Castle. King John was forced to swear to Magna Carta, the great document guaranteeing the fundamental rights and privileges of British citizens. When John died, the Earl of Pembroke, hero of Watson's play, became protector of England during the minority of Henry III. In spite of defeat, the French held London and other parts of England for a while. And the problem of the play is that the Earl of Surrey is still held by them. Lord Surrey, Pembroke's daughter, enters in Act III and takes over the play. Tryphosa Jane Wallace had been recruited from a major provincial theater to play the part. See, that's why actresses change their names. Who's going to really go for an actress's name, Tryphosa? Anyway, she happened to be the adopted daughter of Lord Loughborough. Get it? Adopted daughter of Lord Chancellor? And been with them since her mother died when she was late, 11. Lady Loughborough had bought her a dress reputed to cost £100 for her Covent Garden debut as Sissamunga in 1789. And she provided another dress for England Preserve, one rumored to have cost £1,000. Again, just an enormous sum of money. Act III opens with Lady Surrey's joyous anticipation of her husband's arrival. But a knight tells her that he has been captured by the French as he tried to return to the king. An emotional scene ensues in which she shrieks, nearly faints, feels her judgment disturbed, and then resolves to find him. She asks Pembroke to keep her son while she disguises herself and goes to her husband. She finds him. There is an emotional reunion, and a sympathetic guard helps her escape with the promise of following the story. She returns to the castle and hears he has been recaptured, providing another scene in which he is unhinged with grief, worry, and shrieks. You sort of get the rhythm of this play. Unlike Belvedere, she is able to be loyal both to her father and her husband, and was widely interpreted in the press as representing, quote, the horrors and miseries incident to a country in a state of civil war. So this play was directed against the kinds of of unhappiness citizens without bread were expressing. Popular culture theorists have taught us that small differences in conventional formulate parts and incidents are profoundly revealing. And that is true with the dramatic wartime women like Lady Surrey. Lady Surrey is the loving wife and trusting daughter, but also the perfect wartime mother. In one of her first speeches, she exalts to her son, who has wished he were old enough to fight. See the theme? Quote, "Oh, may thy manly prime fulfill the hopes thy childhood gives. To think I've given to my native land a guardian hero." End quote. Those of you with sons might want to memorize that. Siddons often appeared on stage, or daughters too. Siddons often appeared on stage and was portrayed in prints with her son and other child actors. And Lady Surrey has a major scene of this kind, which even the Times labeled a stage trick. And notice that wartime woman. Can you all see that clearly? Notice the little boy with her, but notice that her fist is up in that wartime thing. And this is Siddons. She was the greatest actress of the time, and she was famous for appearing on stage with children, her children. And so she was reinforcing the image of mother. And look how she looks at him, and she's a little worried. But he's looking at her with utter devotion and loyalty. If you look at a whole lot of 18th century portraits, usually it's a dog, usually a spaniel, that's in that position and with that expression. Okay. Lady Surrey appears to have been written for Elizabeth Pope. There's Elizabeth Pope. She was one of the two greatest actresses of the time, and much more beautiful than Sarah Siddons, and modeled on the domestic vogue at mid-century. But Pope was already in ill health. Interestingly, Covent Garden's sequential attempts to replace Pope had already introduced into the discussion a stronger emphasis on the way the very nature of woman, and incidentally, of the ideal wartime woman. And that, as much as acting ability and interpretation, determined audience and press judgment. This is an example of the way portrayals of wartime women provide another avenue for analyzing topics of central interest to feminist critics and historians, such as controversies over the nature and capacities of women that shape the situation of women. Notice that that with all her lace and her crown, she's beautifully feminine. And Siddons, with her little son, is very... But there, you have the wartime woman who could be leading into battle. So these contrasting images of women come up over and over. Many reviewers of Watson's play said that Wallace was not up to the part of Lady Surrey. And a few questioned whether any actress, any woman, a topic perhaps suggested by the role itself. The Star said that, quote, "The incessant labor requisite to fill the part of Lady Surrey is actually beyond the bodily powers of the female frame." End quote. Watson had tried to take advantage of the perception of the nature of woman and the familiar, highly successful theatrical moments made femininity seem to be Lady Surrey's true character. She is aroused to unnatural actions by the situation of her husband and displays contradictory characteristics, that of the product of the times and significantly needed by the times. She displays bursts of courage described as, quote, "beyond women's nature," end quote, and then collapses into end of the century feminine debilitation, physical and mental. Speeches promising to, quote, "for a husband rise above my sex," end quote, and, quote, "I'm prepared for all and cannot now be moved," end quote, alternate with, quote, "the sudden death of hope disturbs my judgment," end quote. Her part was a telling combination of the performance of the classic madness of earlier tragic heroines and of the coming Victorian hysterics. Lady Surrey's near madness was effective for some of the audience. as was a scene in the prison when suspense is created by her weakness, nearly exposing her husband and the sympathetic guard to the French. Described as a highly wrought scene of a wife's natural reaction, most reviewers liked it. However, unlike Tragic Women, whose madness inevitably precedes death, Lady Surrey, being guiltless, always returns as a needle to true north to the characteristics identified with ideal women in the period. Alternately, she exhibited another demand upon women at a time when the British government was drilling Kentish housewives with pitchforks to repel a possible French invasion, a willingness to fight. At the close of Act Three, she refuses to let her brother seek her husband. No, by my suffering, no. One I have lost, one hero to my country. She can bear no second loss in thee. Watson brings her suffering to the audience's attention, writes the patriotic speech, and then closes with her resolution to go herself that the times, not women's nature, called for. These scenes conclude with women's nature triumphing as her brain grows feverish and my heart grows cold, as she says in Act Three. In fact, Watson has her summarize this theory of wartime women. Women, aroused by pure and virtuous love, defies all nature's obstacles combined. Her soul, exalted even above itself, over hill and precipice and rocky glen, swift as the winds, she'll wing her fearless flight. Snatch amidst death, her great inspiring pride, then stuck with what she's passed, her courage lose, her danger swell, and sinking on herself, be all the timid female or again. So she would grab a sword and rush out, and then she would become the timid household girl. Lady Surrey is a compound of earlier wartime women, as she is both strongly feminine and domestic, and also has within her the passions of Boadicea and other figures. Up to that time, the fashion for tragic heroines swung between those like Elizabeth Barry and Sarah Siddons, who aroused fear and awe and never were accused of bodily weakness. There you have the pairs. The top two are Elizabeth Barry and Sarah Siddons. And they were the tragic heroines who aroused fear and awe. And they were never accused of the kind of bodily weakness that we are hearing come up as a theme about Trefosa and about Lady Surrey. One of their directors, Thomas Betterton, said of Barry that when other actresses ran out of breath, she rose to greater heights in the same speeches. So it was in these long, dramatic, emotional speeches they were really tested. The two women at the bottom are Anne Crawford Barry and Susanna Sibber, who are actually right in between them. In the time period around 1745 through 65, which was the age of sensibility. And so there's a cult of sensibility, sensitivity, and feeling. And they, in tragedy, were primarily associated with pity. All of the actresses in the fear and awe category had distinguishing qualities: height, commanding presence, stunning voices, piercing eyes, or striking, even muscular figures. And reviewers actually talk about the muscles and which actresses are muscular and which not. And notice that the women in the sensibility, the pity group of tragic heroines are looking in a very feminine way, almost at nothing, sort of dreamy. And you get these strong profiles with almost Roman noses on the women who inspired all. Wallace was of medium height, pretty, graceful, and with a voice that could not sustain the desirable versatility of Helen and Lady. There she is. She had a tendency to act with her arms folded. It's hard to find a picture of her that's not just the head, where her arms aren't folded like that, or posed in front of her. A habit that contributed to some part but in England preserved, sometimes seemed unnatural and languid. Here's another picture of her. The doubleness of the demand at a time, puts on wartime women, seems to be unbroken. One of the interesting things about the pictures of Wallace is that one of the ways that people were drawn to the theater was to look at the fashion. So if you look at what Wallace was wearing in her 1,000-pound dress, you could get dressing tips and go home and copy them, or you could pay your dressmaker. And when the play started waning, her husband made all the admirals in London attend the play. So if you wanted to be in the audience, you could go watch the admirals. And if you were a woman, you could watch your dresses. Anyway, the doubleness seems to be there. Reading these pairs is revelatory, as we find wartime women characters created as texts of culture, or as Lady Surrey was, a medium of propaganda, to soon become mediums of culture, something with lasting reverberations. Lauren Bacall died in August 2014, and an appraisal in the New York Times read, quote, "Her voice comes at you low and flat, wildly insinuating, electric and lingering." In another age, Bacall's voice might have been called mannish. But in 1944, she was projecting an indelible screen persona, that of the tough, quick-witted American woman who could fight the good fight alongside her man. She may not have been Rosie the Riveter, but there was something that suggested a stubborn strength that could stand up to the times. This was said of her first film, To Have or Have Not, and Bacall is slim, persuades fishing boat Captain Harry Morgan, Bogart, to transport members of the French resistance, helping him outfox French harbor authorities in the process. So you see that you get the same woman who can be quintessential and feminine, and then actually lead men, inspire them to go out and fight. And Rosie the Riveter, in an interesting way, is sort of domestic, because she has to fill in, sort of like the housewife who has to fix the plumbing if her husband is still at work, and is supposed to return very happily to the home as soon as she can. So the Bacall Rosie Riveter image actually sort of replicates the duality of the early examples. Ronald Paulson has pointed out the dominance of female allegorical figures in France. Reason, nature, truth, equality, and even fraternity were women. He agrees that the collective violence of seizing liberty and overthrowing the monarchy were effaced behind the tranquil visage and statuesque pose of an aloof goddess, the female figure of liberty. On both sides of the channel, iconic figures of women were depicted leading men and citizens into battle, as Lady Surrey intends to do. When Lady Surrey seizes her brother's sword and shouts, "Follow me, brother, I can brave the field," she performs the parts of liberty in Britannia, rising to express Britishness, male and female, therefore willing to send men to battle and willing to go herself, sometimes becoming greater than herself and womankind, sometimes on the edge of surrendering to the hysteria of the time, always longing to be in the arms of husband and son. She was intended to be a fascinating spectacle of the time. By depicting the misery war causes women, the impact on the domestic front, Watson's play was timely. Wallace was to hit the notes of the conflicted times with her swings in motion. In the final tableau, Wallace, a rather ordinary woman, an ordinary actress, united both a lower class and aristocratic body, surrounded by father, husband, and son, with peace restored. Siddons had posed as tragedy, and Britannia could be the iconic allegorical figure. But tellingly, prints were already showing this. French liberty as the Medusa-haired wild woman. The Lord Chancellor's carefully titled England Preserved offers a gauge of where Britain was in its journey from engagement with internal reform to united effort to defeat the most serious military threat the nation had ever faced. Such parts are instructions to women on what their nation needs in times of war. Notice that this is clearly propaganda, because look at the words that are associated with a French iconic woman and the words for the Britannic figure. And once again, there's this help and reassuring calmness in the British figure. And many, I mean, look at the heads on the pitchfork. So there's the duality of the image. Thank you very much. I am willing to answer questions if I haven't worn you all out or depressed you. Yes.
I don't know if it's a question or just an observation. I was thinking when you were showing the wartime woman with the fist in the air, have you seen the image from Ferguson of the woman who's a pastor who's standing in front of her African-American youth group, and she's doing this, and they have worn, they're all wearing bandanas around their faces to keep the tear gas off, and so they're kind of reappropriating some imagery there, and she's before them and she's standing there, she blocked them. And then there's another image of the same woman. She got hit with a rubber bullet and she shows her wound, and there's an image of that. So I was just thinking about that interesting thing of she's the protector and she's doing the fist, but she's doing a peace sign as she does it. That.
Yeah, that's really interesting. Maybe, yeah, that would really get me into new kinds. I once gave a paper in Berkeley, and two rows of military men filmed in the back. And I kept wondering, are they going to be for or against what I'm going to say? That's really interesting, Shay. I think what really got me into this to begin with was there are so many things men can't say, particularly in the 18th century, without getting arrested for treason or sedition or all kinds of things. And so they can use a woman's body and they can inscribe mourning, violence, violation, suffering. They can really make her body a text that we can all read. And that's exactly what you're saying. And just like these images, they very often have something really iconic in them, like the pitchfork in the heads and the Medusa hair, and even the very way that she's sitting and holding the scales of justice. And if you go back and look at those Vietnam pictures, the runaway who's over the body of the fallen student is in a very traditional mourning position. And so it's so when you start combining the way the parts are cast, the reconstruction from reviews and eyewitness descriptions with the text itself, then you see just how eloquent these women's bodies are. Yes?
I was really interested in how you talked about the Venice Preserve revivalist. How does Bonaduca fit into this? You have a female warrior character at the center of it. Was the casting done with the same political sensitivity?
You know, that's a really good question. I read from you from two of the three chapters that I have in this, some form of, I don't know, construction, that's a good word. And I'm auditioning her. She's a really, really popular subject around the time of Queen Anne. And then there are revivals throughout the century, and her name changes, and people revive her plays. But, all of you can come by and pick up about five drama books and move them from my office to my house. That'd be great. I'm gradually moving my whole drama collection so I can read those plays in a bunch. But I'm auditioning her. So what would you recommend? Should I do her?
Yeah.
I'm kind of thinking about, you couldn't act King Lear during the time when George III went mad. but you could depict King George as Farmer George. So I'm thinking about looking at the women surrounding the Farmer George characters. That's another group auditioning. Are there other questions? Yes, Tom.
How did the portrayal of tragic women help the war effort?
Well, you know, that's not a simple question. Because obviously some playwrights and even some theaters were more associated with propagating for war, and others not. And as a cultural studies person, I tend to work in bites of 2 to 5 years. So at any moment, that might not, that might change. I will say, though, that I think that in general, with popular culture plays and the theater of popular media, that when a war starts and there's a divided opinion, there's a kind of almost frenetic searching around for a narrative that makes sense of what's happening. And notice that that makes sense. Thelwall being accused of treason for applauding a character in a play written 100 years earlier doesn't really make sense, but that does. And so if you look at the movies surrounding the Vietnam War, you know, we got some really wacky images. We got John Wayne stomping around Vietnam, remember that? And then we got Sylvester Stallone, which hated authority and administration almost as much as he hated the Viet Cong. And then we got some very nuanced movies, like Born on the 4th of July and Deliverance. But then, when you think about it, when we got into Desert Storm, we were ready. We all knew how to chant. We may not like the war, but we support our men. And so if you follow that trajectory of any sort of moment when public opinion is very divided and consensus about something like a war is not there, that you then find the theater or popular culture, film, novels, participating very actively in trying to give us a narrative that makes sense. So one of the things that I do, you know, you don't have a whole chapter of anything here. You don't know how lucky you are. But anyway, is that I work out that negotiation toward a story that at least satisfies people enough that there's a decrease in tension and factionalism. Does that answer your question? Other questions? Okay, thank you very much.